Hello, everybody. Thank you for having me, Dr. Kenneth. It's a pleasure having being here. How long do we have?
We have until 11, so 45.
Okay, babe. So it's actually, I came here to give you a pop quiz, so close everything and see how you guys are doing, actually. We're going to be talking today about social medicine. That's the main concept of NuHealth. NuHealth started here. Started in 2006 at this public school in Santiago del Estero in Argentina. And we used to go around the countries and put computers with a Debian GNU Linux. And at one point in time, I said, hey, you know, these kids need something before than computers, you know. Because some of them were just, walking to school 10 kilometers, 12 kilometers, not enough nutrition on them. So we make me think, what can we do, you know, in order to achieve global health, you know, in a holistic way. And I always put this picture because I like to see myself with some more hair. I was here. Time goes by. But that time I said, what can we do with computers? Being a computer scientist and being involved in the health area, so let's build something that takes care of the two things. So NuHealth tries to achieve those four areas, right? The first area, it's the person and the community, you know. The people, the community, the socioeconomic conditions, how the infrastructure of that place is. Then we move to the patient. And that's what they call today an electronic medical record. You know, doctor-patient relationship, prescriptions, evaluation, encounters, and so on. Next step would be, well, now how do we take care of the health institution itself? Stock, finances, hospitalization, lab, operations, surgeries, and so on. And finally, we have to make sense of all the data that we've been collecting on those three prior steps. That's where the Ministry of Health jumps in. And that's where we get data aggregation, epidemiology, demographics, and so on. NuHealth is free software. And free means freedom. Means that doesn't belong to any provider, it belongs to you. And that's a very big thing, because then you have the power to change it, adapt it to your need, modify it, and feedback and retrofit the community. When we work on it, we want to get as many people as possible, so everything is open from the documentation portal to the translation. Today, NuHealth has been translated to over 100 languages. So let's talk about social medicine. If we talk about, and if we see the numbers that we are running today, over one soccer stadium of dead children are every day. And these kids are dying, most of them, from social diseases. Things that are preventable in most cases. And those preventive measures are quite simple. So when we talk about prostitution, when we talk about child labor, when we talk about tuberculosis, when we talk about Ebola, we are talking about social diseases. And we have to address that. Social diseases mean diseases that come from the socioeconomic conditions, you know, from the lack of empathy of people, and affect to the most needed. I was reading the New England last year on a trip, and this sentence of Dr. Chan struck me, you know, when she was asked by people why the Ebola outbreak in West Africa was so devastating and so difficult to contain, the answer was a single word, was poverty. Same happens with tuberculosis. Many of us might have the bacteria, but yet you live with it for the rest of your life and you are so healthy. Now, who dies out of TB? Well, that one that is undernourished, that is poor, and those are the things that are going to affect your immune system at the end of the day. And by the way, HIV and TB makes a very good friendship. That's why, you know, they go together, and people with HIV is very affected by TB. So we had to change from the system of disease to a new paradigm, which is the system of health. When we just look at the circles, we will see that the system of disease that we are pretty much living on in the Western world has less circles, you know, because it's reductionist by nature. We deal with patients. We deal with diseases. But seldom we deal with people and the socioeconomic condition. Seldom people say, hey, how is your work? How are you doing with your family? What is the level of affection that you have with your mates, with your colleagues, with your parents? And that's what New Health tries to do. So the initial assessment is like, before going into the places, we need to know which people is living there. So for example, in Argentina, when we studied in Entre Rios, we got the census of everybody that was living there. And we are talking on healthy people. But before putting all that information, we have also to know, as we are putting here, what are the type of houses, what are the living conditions and housing conditions and sanitary conditions of those people that are actually living there. So that's where the social workers figure comes in. So they have time to go house by house, see how they are living, how many people is living there, what type of material is in that house, and we will see the nexus on some endemic diseases and the type of housing material that we have there. You can also geolocate it. Not every house has an address. Then you build the list of the health institutions so you kind of segment the area on which institution is responsible for the health program within your area. And then you take, when I say people before patients, you take the demographics of the people that is actually living there. What is her work, education, domiciliary unit that we talked before, you are already linking it here. So the system will know what are the habitants on that specific dynamic DU, ethnic group, civil status. That's also give you the mother and the father by the birth certificate. We move to the families. Okay, so now you have the house, you have the person, and you have the family. Before actually getting into the patient, nobody is a patient at this point. Yet, at this point, you can also say, who is actually part of the system of health. Because many people is not part of the system of health. So before becoming a patient, you already have all this information that is crucial for the health authorities to improve their health campaigns, specifically to that group of risk groups that you already have collected, working with the social worker or even with the person himself or herself. So we try to empower the people. We try to make that people that in the system of disease that we were talking before, it was a passive actor, was someone that it was actually being given orders by. Now we try to say, hey, you have rights, but you also are part of the community and part of the family and part of the society. So as a building block, you also have to be an active actor of this whole system. So one of the things that we do in this case, and before talking about patients, is let's look at the houses. And this is an example on the Chagas disease module, part of the neglected tropical diseases, that allows you to go house by house and see the type of living and dwelling that you have. And we know those who have been living in Latin America that the type of housing is the major key factor for Chagas disease. So again, all of this has been done before you have somebody with the illness. One step forward is we are going to give you now the chance as a citizen to report on whatever you want. It can be your demographics, you are changing place, you have a new degree, or it can be something more serious as you have been sexually assaulted, or you have seen something about domestic violence. With the privacy that it will confer you putting that information without going to the doctor and talking to the doctor himself. So this information will allow you as a person to log in into the system and put that you have been either a victim or something that you want to report. So this is, I think, a key figure because many times people is afraid to talk to the health officials. So now you have your own environment to log in there and update the information or actually talk about something that you are not willing to say face to face. Then, of course, the social services will get in and help you out with it. Now, okay, we talked about what happens at the first level, okay? Person level, community, family. Now we move to the practical, to the medical practice. And you see that NuHealth is a set of modules, okay? So depending on your institution, you will install the modules that actually are going to be beneficial for your system. We try to make the system as simple as possible, so we have what would be a centralized patient control center. So from this main screen, you can pretty much have most of the information about the patient himself or herself. And from there, you can jump to evaluation, encounters, appointments, lab, whatever it has to do with the day-by-day in the encounters and dealing with the person himself or herself. You see, this part here is in gray. That is being taken automatically by the history of the person himself. Okay? So many things are just going to stir there. So in this case, if she's allergic, she has allergies, or if she has a chronic disease, no matter where you are on the screen, you will be able to actually see it. And small parenthesis on one of the modules that is, or two modules, one of obstetrics and pediatrics. We try to, again, mix and merge not only the biological part of it, but also the social one. Talk about the psychosocial risk, the pediatric system symptom checks by the Mass General Hospital, the APGAR score on the family, immunization, nutrition. This is what would be part of the WHO growth charts. And you can also generate what would be like the wristbands or ID of that baby itself. But again, most important things of all of that, the socioeconomics and how to help not only the baby, but the mother, or the preconception and prenatal care, you know. One of the other interesting things that we've made is try to group diseases, because again, if we separate a little bit the pure biological part of it and we talk about the tuberculosis case, we see that yes, we can encode it on ICD-10 as we do in the case of respiratory tuberculosis, but I also want to group it. You know, why grouping it? Because it's going to let me do specific actions depending on the group that it is, or the groups. So can we say that tuberculosis is a respiratory disease? Sure. Can we say that it's an infectious disease? Of course. Now, is it also a social disease? We said yes. And in many countries, it's a notifiable disease. It means that at the moment that I detect that somebody has TB, I have to immediately call the Ministry of Health and say, hey, you know, here I have an index case of TB. By doing this, I can automatically set up triggers that do all that for me. And then the MOH will be able to work on specific campaigns on health promotion and disease prevention based on this. Again, social and family diseases are part of the core of new health. Other things that we try to do is give screening tools and scores to the health professional to make the things easier for them. So here, for example, we have the CAGE alcoholism score. And you will have the progression on that person, that specific addiction. You have NIDA database for drugs. You have the family APGAR functionality test that we talked before. And the idea is to make things easier. You just don't want to be typing things since you want to get a result that will actually put you on what level of whatever test you are taking from there. By the way, this type of tests, here I'm putting the psychosocial risk of the MGH, can be done by that citizen portal that we talked before. So somebody can just say, hey, I want to enter the family guard, I'll just go to the citizen portal and I will put that information without the need of actually going to the health center. Some of our things that we do is make the information available at all time. So if I have a patient that is type 1 diabetes, I want to have that information on something that she's wearing or she's having. And in the case that she has some issues, it can be retrieved by any health official at any time. We have also incorporated digital signature for most of the documents, meaning that as a health professional, I can actually sign using GNU PG Privacy Guard. In this case, we have a prescription, but you can do the same for an evaluation, surgery, and other type of medical processes or procedures. And finally, now that we've been working with the person, the house, the family, the institution, we have to make sense of all that data that has been put around. And that's where we, first of all, have to come to some sort of standards. And in this case, we are using HL7 FHIR for the possibility of linking together heterogeneous systems, you know? Because new health system with new health system talk very well because they use the same protocols, but if we want to connect, for example, I don't know, open MRS with new health, then we have to look for something that actually talk the same language. So you can say, yeah, can I export data in XML? Yes, you can, but we want to have an upper layer. In this case, HL7 FHIR looks to me like the evolution of the HL7 standard. It's open, and it has very good test servers and very well documented. So we decided to actually choose it from 2.0 and on. One key factor also, in many countries, you move from one health center to the other, you are a different people. You're a different person, okay? Your health history will be here, and then you go to another health center tomorrow, and you will be another person with another history, and these two don't talk to each other. So what we have done is create the person unique ID. This means that no matter where you are in the country, or even in the world, you should have one single clinical history and personal history. Okay, so if I'm in Buenos Aires and tomorrow I'm in Cordoba, that information has to be updated in real time. And as a matter of fact, it is updated in real time. Because that's one of the major issues we're having today. It doesn't only happen in Argentina, it happens all over. In Spain, it's pretty much the same. So what we have done is create an aggregation synchronization engine that we will talk a little bit later now when we get into one of the cases. So we have all that data, and this is part of the things that we want to do at the health authority level, right? So we have large amount of data coming every single day, and we need to use it to improve basically our health campaigns, health promotion and disease prevention, being able to have some sort of early warning system that detects possible outbreaks. As I said before, you know, see what is the amount of people that has no health coverage. And the other parts, like being able to interact with other entities like vital record systems, you know, birth and death certificates. Injury surveillance system actually comes from our Jamaica implementation, deals with violent injuries. They can be accident or they can be non-accidental. So you deal with work accidents, you deal with robberies, you deal with sexual assaults, you deal with suicide attempts, and so on. So all this information, most of the time, is gathered at the ER, and then it's connected directly to the system, so you can actually pinpoint all the hotspots. And they are encoded on ICD-10, and it will allow you to make a map of violent injuries. So then from there, you can say, okay, what type of violent injuries are prevalent in different areas? Very interesting. You can work on specific, in this case, we're talking about the immunizations. You know, do personalized campaigns, depending if we talk about the immunization, which group of people has current vaccines based on the schedule for your country and for that year on your country. Vital record systems. This is quite interesting because it takes value of legal, administrative, medical, and epidemiology. Meaning somebody can, again, see what not only what was the ultimate cause of death, but the conditions that were before and led to that. So that from the epidemiological point of view has a lot of value. And you don't really need to get into the patient to actually be able to work with that information, of course, having the right permission access to it. Finally, reaching out, that's what we're doing today, you know. We have a big role in the academia. This is our class today, but we've been in different places in the world. This is at the United Nations University in Malaysia. We've been in Entre Rios. We've been in Japan. Many institutions around the world. For me, the university and academia is the most important point of both getting people into the project and also to reach out and spread the word about free software in healthcare. We also try to work with WHO as much as we can. Many examples, for example, here we have included modules specifically for Millennium Development Goals, malaria, TB, and HIV, AIDS. We use the essential list of medicines. We use ICD-10, ICPM for procedures, immunization schedules, and pediatric work. Growth charts that we saw before. And we try to attend to different forums led by, in this case, ITU or WHO itself. And finally, just as a case example, I would like to talk a bit about the implementation that the Jamaica government is doing by implementing new health at national level. This is a large project, long-term project, where we try to have the whole, well, not that we try, they try to roll out new health in all their public health institutions across the country. They have around 350 health center, public health centers. And what we try to do is actually give the project sustainability. So today, as in today, it's led by a local team of people from computer scientists and health professionals. All the system is actually based in free software, both at the workstations and also at the server level. And as we talked before, we tried to give, we have actually the unique ID for every single citizen. Then data will be aggregated in a form that each health institution will send the data to the Ministry of Health in real time. This is part of how we are segmenting the country and the different health institutions. And of course, they started with primary care centers, and they will go up in more specialized institutions. And that was short, I think, which gave us time to questions. And I hope you get an idea. It's a very large system, but I try to focus on the social aspects of it. So thank you. Any questions you may have? Thank you.
Luis, I have a question from you. For you. One of our international participants, Yuda Saputra, is asking and echoing her question, how can you ensure the security and privacy of the patient data? You know, we hear about these big data leaks with things like Anthem in the news recently, and a system like this seems to put multiple patients at significant vulnerability and risk. So how do you guys propose to keep this secure?
Well, NewHealth is a framework, and we try to put the tools that will give you privacy. One of them we talked before, it was NewPG. That allows you not only to sign documents, but also to encrypt documents. But at the end of the day, you have people dealing with systems. And funny enough, I read in Spain, they found a nurse with a bunch of clinical records, paper-based clinical records, at his place, her place, that she tried to sell them, you know, the information. That happens everywhere. So it's a human, and I'm not talking now electronic, I'm talking about paper-based. So NewHealth has a very strict ACL. You can go specific at actually field level and even the value of those fields. So you can actually create very good and secure access control list. Now, there is always someone that is going to be have the right access to, for example, the health professionals. I mean, you or I as a doctor need to have access to my patients. Now, what I do with that, it's at the level that I cannot control from our point. So you have very good security rules. You can encrypt data. You can sign documents. So then you have the accountability for it. But at the end of the day, security is as old as humans, you know, and crooks are also as old as humans. So that's something that is taking at another level. I hope that kind of answer was.
It does. If I may ask one follow-up. You mentioned the possibility of someone who was assaulted or the victim of sexual assault being able to go on and report on one of the platforms. Is that anonymous? Is that person reporting through their own PUID? And how is that controlled?
Well, that's one of the scenarios that you can see. Sexual assaults, you have also like domestic violence and so on. It is anonymous. We are actually working on the citizen portal now. So the information, of course, will be linked to your person, because at the end of the day, that is going to be part of your history, and the social services will look at it. You have something that, when you are a person, allows you to not pass information about yourself. So I can go today to be myself checked and say, no, I don't want to pass any of my documentation. And by law, you can also do that. So you have the possibility of saying, no, I don't want my data to be recorded. And then you will have an NN, what they call NN ID, and put all the data. But usually, you want to actually link it to your to yourself, so we can take care of you better.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I have a question about this data security still. I pushed it. Problem is, you told that you are implementing this. You are offering this program to governments or just single patients or communities, because I was confused who is holding the server, who is managing that all data server, and who is responsible of that?
Well, GNU Health is it's free software. Anybody can download it from the GNU.org. Now, the information is supposed, in the case of Jamaica, is the Ministry of Health who's actually holding all the information. Now, some private institutions are already working with it, and that is their sphere of holding that information.
This is like just toolkit for Ministry of Health to implement in universal electronic records, nothing else.
Well, it's not an a health, as I said, it tried to cover both, the person level, the community level, and of course
same
the patient.
Same thing, yeah.
So it's intended to be for public health, but many private institutions is using them. Then data is stored at a database, and then the way that you lay it out, it varies on your institution.
I'm still over using time, maybe. Mostly, countries, mostly OECD countries who actually implement electronic medical records, they have their own vision, which kind of system, how those systems should be designed, how the system is better. For example, if you offer this system, how is this better than if they will hire programmers, specialists, they buy servers and they design their own system. How is this better than that system, which actually Ministry of Health is doing under the interests?
Well, I guess what's better is very subjective, right? I mean, I'm pretty sure that the programmer that is here, he would say is seems best, but we try to first make it free as in freedom. So that's a big plus already. And then we also try to work with an open international community. So we use open standards, we use ICD-10, we use Firewood. The idea is to make something that allows you as a Ministry of Health or a health institution to first be able to use the system and then adapt it to your needs. Being free software, that's one of the big plus it has. And also I think that older paradigms of being, having a bunch of people working on specific, then you depend on that group of programmers that today are here and tomorrow they won't. So free software gives you that umbrella of knowing, well, the system is there, it's open, anybody can contribute to it. Mm-hmm. I think those are the pretty
Thank you.
Pleasant.
I have a question. Can you talk about the training, what efforts New Health is doing to extend the training to developing countries, for example? That's one of the biggest challenges in adopting this solution. And also, the second question is the unique ID system. What of a system that already has their own unique ID system? How do you reconcile that, or you just?
The first one is training. We try to do workshops around the world. Last year we did it in Japan, in Turkey, in Argentina, in Spain. Universities are now doing their own workshops, you know, and having people from their own computer science or health science enroll in these workshops. So, again, we try to make the system sustainable in the area that they are going to be using. So, and then there are companies that give training. But the idea is to, as I said before, the role of academia, being able to integrate New Health in their curriculum. So you train within your classes, and then when you get out, you can be able to implement it in your health institutions. Unique ID, that's a great question, and it's hard to see something that is not going to be using a unique ID nowadays. The idea is you have every single health center is autonomous, meaning they don't depend on the network. If the network goes down, you still be able to work, but then there is a synchronization engine that will take the information that you have here, check with the Ministry of Health, and bring that information back updated. If you have new information here, the Ministry of Health will get updated, and vice versa. It has a low-level Triton synchro engine that actually takes care of that. It's quite technical, but if we look at the, you know, abstraction level, basically means that the information that I have here today will be updated at the MOH, so tomorrow when I go to this new center, all that information is queried and I'll have the most updated record on the other system.
You know, the training from the private company usually comes at a cost, but the university workshops, are they free?
Are free? Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And that's part of what we have something that is called a social contract, that when we do with the universities, that must be free. So everybody is able to attend and be part of it.
Thank you so much for your presentation. It's very informative.
Thank you, Vanessa. Thank you, guys.